Yeah, I was originally born and raised in Brandon, Mississippi, and Brandon is like 15 miles south of Jackson, so pretty close to the Jackson, Mississippi area. I actually, in high school, I definitely thought I was going to be doing something else in life, but in 1967, my oldest brother, Cletus Anderson, he opened up the first V.I.P. record store in Los Angeles in South Central on 108th and Broadway. And it was probably like, the store was probably like 10 by 10 in size. There was a friend of his who owned a cleaner next door who also owned the building that for some reason or another convinced him to get into the music business. So he got into the business, and that was in 67. So I have, between me and him, I have two more brothers, David and Glenn. So when someone would finish high school in Mississippi, they would come to California and work for him. So when I graduated in 1972, it was funny, I'll never forget that. I graduated May the 22nd. On the 23rd, I said bye to all my friends and family, and on the 24th, I caught a Delta flight at 6 o'clock in the morning. I made it to Los Angeles at 10:30 LA time. He took me to breakfast, and took me by his house to drop off my clothes, and took me to work. So, 2 o'clock LA time, from 6 o'clock in the morning, you know, and basically I lived in the country, so I had that life changed in a matter of probably like 5 or 6 hours. So I went to work in the music business around, like I said, 2 o'clock the same day, and it's been nonstop ever since.
So what was the business like during that time? Because you're talking the 60s, I mean, you know,
Well, the 70s, yeah, the early 70s.
And the lot of R&B and a lot of stuff was jumping off at that time. Did you want to be in the business, or you just kind of got dropped in the middle of it?
Oh, yeah, my life was set for me. I had a choice, but I didn't have a choice. I mean, it's like, that was a perfect opportunity for me. So what had happened, and at that time, you know, what we was buying then was, 8 tracks, 45s, and a few LPs from time to time.
Oh,
so,
yeah.
You know, I definitely remember the 8-track days. And my brother, one of the special things about him and how VIP during the 70s and 80s was the most popular record store in LA County was the fact that he had this thing where, matter of fact, our motto was think low prices, think VIP, because he wasn't concerned about making a lot of money per item. Mm-hmm. He wanted as many people as he could possibly get
right in
the store. So we were probably outside, and that was really before the chain stores got as big as they did get, like Warehouse and Music Land and Music Plus and all those stores. We were probably the only independent store that was probably selling as much music as they were. So, and we had a unique marketing skill that a lot of people pattern themselves after. And by the way, in 1970, my brother had relocated from the small store into like a huge store. Actually, we moved from 108th and Broadway to 108th and Main, so we had a pretty large store over there when I came to work. So it was four brothers working in this one store, and we were all full of energy, and we just had, you know, great sales skills. First of all, you know, in that business, you had to know the music. You had to know what customers was probably looking for. So that means that you had to know what was happening on the jazz station, on the gospel station. And I don't know, and I haven't figured it out, but it had got to a point where you could come in. I've had customers come in the store and they said, man, I'm looking for this song, and I can't think of the name of it. I can't think of who it's by. I said, is it a man, a lady, or a group? He said, I don't know, man, but it's just tearing me up. And, you know, I said, and I would take that song and put it on and play it. He said, that's it. You're like, how did you know and stuff? So I'm like, I don't really know how I know, but, you know, when that's your business to know, and you that in tune with what's going on and stuff. And it had to be something that was real popular at the time because he had been hearing it a lot. So we just had this, you know, skill and ability to really, you know, search people, I guess, their inner thought, mind and thought. So we was real good at it.
So now the store expanded. I mean, didn't you go to multi locations at some point?
Yeah, and after I would say late 72, early 73, we decided to start opening up multi locations. So the next store, well, the first store I opened was Vernon and Figueroa in LA. Then I opened a store in Pasadena on Orange Grove and Fair Oaks. We opened a store in Manchester and Vermont. In 1974, I opened up the biggest VIP store ever as far as business-wise, and it was on 28th and Crenshaw. Those, even though Long Beach is a very popular store, those were my best days on 28th and Crenshaw because our customers was people like Red Fox, Barry White. You know, a lot of the celebrities and artists and athletes came there. So, you know, we had a real good time there. And at that time, actually before that location, one of the things that we had incorporated in our store is that we had, you know, salespeople and we had cashiers. And people that were salespeople, that's when we brought in like turntables in the store. So your job all day was just to play music. And, you know, we always marketed who was in the store at that time and stuff. So if we got gospel customers in the store, we playing gospel. You know, if we got blues customers, we playing blues. So, you know, we were real targeted in the way we, targeted and aggressive in the way we played and sold music.
How did you end up in Long Beach? When did Long Beach come on the scene?
In 1978, June of 1978, I opened up the Long Beach store for my brother. And 6 months later, January of 1979, I bought it from him. What had happened was that was the last store that I had opened for him. I recently bought a home in Carson. And what he was doing at that time was downsizing. So he had offered locations to each one of, you know, the brothers. And so I took that location since it was the last one that I had opened and kind of close to where I was living. So I took the Long Beach store, and from that point, and really, I started in 72, it ended in 79, and I looked at those 70 years as my degree, my college education and the business and stuff, because, you know, the person, and I looked at McDonald's franchise and stuff, they said the best operator of a McDonald's French fries is the guy that started with the mop, and he got promoted to fries. And you know, so with me, you know, I started at the bottom in the business. I went to from, you know, salesperson to manager to general manager and stuff. So I knew everything about, you know, the music business. And during the course of those years, I was able to generate relationship with the majors, Warner Brothers, Sony, Capitol, all of those places. So when I became an owner myself, I was already locked in.
So tell us a little bit about how it worked back then in terms of how you would buy, as a buyer, buy product from the majors to stock when
right.
new releases were coming out and that whole thing.
At the time, even want to go one step back. Before, when we had 14 locations, we also, my brother decided to open up his own distributor. So we actually had our own one-stop distributor who not only supplied all our stores, but any other independent retail store in the area could buy from us. So we did that for like around 3 years of the 7 years that I worked for him. And at that time is when I really built the relationship with the majors because, you know, we would buy X amount of products from them, and from buying that, we would get X amount of dollars in free goods or X amount of dollars in marketing money and stuff. So that worked it real good, and that helped us out a lot with being able to be on the radio all the time and market and promote this store. So, but me, once I became a owner, actually we had closed the distributor when he decided to downsize and sell off some of the stores to employees and family members. So at that time, when I opened the store up in 79, I started buying through One Stops. And One Stops, distributors are distributors who carry everybody's products. So I didn't have to go buy from Motown or Warner Brothers. I could go to this One Stop because this One Stop carried all of them. And it wasn't a whole lot different in price. When you buy direct from the distributor or the manufacturer, you probably get a little better rate and you probably get more as far as marketing money, but the convenience of not having to call all of these people, I just call one company and get everything. So that basically, I've over my almost 32 years, I've done not much business direct, even though I'm open to buy direct. And right now, it might be moving back to that because a lot of the love that labels and distributors have had for One Stops over the years, that have changed a lot now because not only is record companies less dependent on retailers such as myself, they are less dependent on One Stops also because without a doubt, and you all know that the music is moving less physical and more digital. And so that is the move of the industry today.
Right. Now, I want to kind of segue a little bit because in addition to the store itself, the retail business, mm-hmm. you kind of found yourself right in the middle of a movement. Right in the middle of a movement. You in right. that neighborhood there right around from Poly High School.
Right.
And all these guys were, you know, these
right.
young lions, if you will, coming through, very creative people doing music.
Right.
Tell us kind of what that scene was, what your place was. I remember coming through there, you had a studio.
Right.
You had a studio in the back corner of the store with the MPC and all that stuff set up back then. The guys would go back there and record.
Right.
Kind of give us some background.
Well, in the early 80s, when, you know, first the rap scene busted out on the East Coast and kind of moved to this area, I guess Compton was the first big area with Easy and all of those guys. And it kind of blew up there. And the next big area to my recollection was the Bay Area, Oakland with Too Short and all of those guys. So I don't know how I ran into this young man, but his name is his professional name is Sir Jinx. Sir Jinx is related to Dr. Dre. And for some reason, he had came to me one day and he said, "Man, I hear you want to bring the rap thing to Long Beach." And he said, I can help you. And he invited me over to Dre's house. And he took me in this room and he showed me this drum machine. He said, "See this right here?" He said, "This is all you need to do what you want to do." I'm like, "That's it?" He said, "Yeah." He said, "This is Dre's drum machine." He said, "And the closest I can get to it is over his shoulder." He said, if you get one of those, we can make this happen." So I actually went to the Guitar Center over in Hawthorne, paid $2,500 for an SB-1200 drum machine, and gave it to him. And I would say in like 3 months, he came to Long Beach and said, "Okay, I'm ready now." So at that time, I had like a storage room that I really wasn't using. So we went back and we set up the drum machine. Matter of fact, the first demos that we did for artists in Long Beach, we used the drum machine, two turntables, and actually recorded it down to a cassette. So Snoop's demo was done on the famous demo that Dre heard and all, actually was recorded to a cassette from the drum machine. And so we had worked with another young man in Long Beach. His rap name was Radio, and he could go nonstop and he could beatbox, so he could make music with his mouth. And that was the first artist that we actually got signed to a major. He got signed to Interscope. And sometimes when you're an artist and you get with a company that's going through a transition, you can get lost. Over the years, I've seen a lot of artists that get, you know, they got lost, because when we signed him to Interscope, even though they liked him, they didn't know how to handle rap. They wasn't, you know, Interscope actually turned Tupac down and stuff, so they didn't know how to handle rap. So he got caught up in that, and when we got him signed, he was like hardcore. And after they signed him, the big artist at that time was like Fozzy MC, if anybody remember Fozzy MC. So Interscope wanted to change him from what he was to like what's happening now. Fozzy MC is what's happening now. So they was trying to change him on to that. And by the time they kind of changed a lot of his music and a lot of his style, Interscope did the deal with Dr. Dre and Suge Knight. And it's like the whole Death Row thing. And when the first project, Dre dropped the first project and it did all of that, then Interscope took radio and tried to change him back. You know, this is, let's take him back. And he just kind of got lost in the shuffle and never really got what he deserved in the business. And he actually passed away. I think he had like sickle cell or something, and he passed away. That was a career that could have been very strong that never got off the ground. And even thinking about that is that a lot of time, it's real important to be talented, but a lot of time it's all about who you're rolling with. Because I've seen artists that was great artists, but they was on the wrong team. You know, I look at, you know, if Eminem would have been on Priority, he would have never made it. That's the truth, you know. I look at, you know, it's just like, for instance, and I say that because a lot of times we'll get the demo in the mail and we'll play it for, you know, customers, and we're like, man, this is hot right there. And they're like, man, I ain't gonna buy that. I don't like that. Nelly was another artist and stuff. We used to play Nelly to death. They like, uh-uh. But what marketing promotion does is that it changes you and stuff. You know, you hear the song 50 times, you see the video 25 times and stuff, and those same people that said that I would never buy this, you know, they coming in and whisper, man, let me get that. I'm like, you know, and I'm like, the one you say you didn't like, oh man, I like it, you know? And I mean, you know, even like, you know, Eminem and stuff. I sold Eminem to senior citizens and stuff. I'm like, what? And stuff. But it's the fact that they hear it so much and see it so much. And a lot of time that you have record companies that will give up on you and stuff. Because the record companies, pretty much their motto is that you might get a single and maybe a single and a half. And if you don't hit then, we going on to the next thing. And which we had for many years and stuff, we had the problem with the remix. And I know some of you have went in and bought a CD and you paid all that money for it and you put it in and like, that ain't the song that I've been hearing, because the radio is playing a remix that ain't gonna ever come out. So, you know, we always had this problem with the industry about marketing, promoting something that they're not selling, because it don't do anything for your project that you're trying to sell. But in radio, we'll play it, because the radio will tell you in a minute, we ain't in the business to sell music. We're in the music business to get listeners and sell advertisement. So we couldn't stop the radio from playing it. And the industry, the reason why they did stuff like that is to maintain chart position on those particular artists, right? Because chart position was, you know, is very important to a record company.
Okay, now, in all of the stuff that was going on in these early artists, mm-hmm. that were happening, you had, you know, Snoop came through with Warren G, and right. Nate, were they all part of that early group of guys that came through V.I.P.?
Right, and I'm sure everyone here is aware that we lost Nate Dogg on the 15th, and, you know, he had a stroke in 2007. He had his first stroke, and he kind of recovered from that a little bit, and then he had the second stroke, and he just never could get back in. You know, as much as, you know, I hate the fact that he's no longer with us, he suffered a long time and stuff. So, but after we had worked with Radio, Snoop was actually the next artist that we worked with. And what I liked about Snoop was that he could be just sitting there flowing. And it's just like, you know, you could just listen to him with no beat or nothing because, I don't know, his whole flow was like musical.
How did you meet him? How did he show up on the scene?
When I had the studio in the back of the store, my thing at that time was that I had equipment, I had a couple of producers back there, and it was just open for, it was basically a hangout in Long Beach. You know, kids either hung out at King's Park or, you know, at the store. And a lot of time it was like a lot of kids in the back, and every now and then I would stick my head in and check out a couple of them. But I was like busy doing my thing up front. But what happened with Snoop, Warren, and Nate is that, you know, I noticed that, you know, we got this guy that was a good DJ, and Snoop was flowing with his rap, and this guy was singing. So we're like, oh, okay, well, man, we like that. So they just was, you know, and what happened with them was we did a four song demo on 213 is what the group was called. We did a four cut demo, and I shopped it around to all of the companies that was into rap then, Jive, Priority, Profile, even shopped it around to Interscope, which, you know, later on, the label that they was on. And, you know, the labels would say stuff like, you know, it sounds good, but not what we're looking for. We heard that, you know, it's just, you know, I don't think they got what it take. Matter of fact, that's what John McClain, he was the A&R director at Interscope at the time, and John McClain, you know, he the one that made Janet Jackson big when he was at A&M. So I remember John McClain saying that about Snoop is that I don't think he has what it take. So I'm like, man, I said, man, you know what I do every day of my life? I said, I put music in the hand of the consumer. I said, I know one thing about me, I can't play an instrument, I can't write music, I can't write a song, I can't even dance. But if you got a hit song, I can tell you, you got a hit song, straight out. So I said, you know, that's all I do, is put music in the hand of the consumer. So I'm like, be honest with you, I'm saying that this kid is not just the best rapper here in Long Beach in Southern California. I said, I don't know nobody better than him in the world. And, you know, this is, and that was, I was being as truthful as possible. So, had no success, you know, in which, you know, any of you all that follow the business, you'll see that artists like R. Kelly, artists like Mary J. Blige, they had shot the deal that a lot of company, and they said, we don't hear anything. So that happens because most A&R directors and departments is stupid anyway. So so after, you know, I actually spent like 6 months trying to get Snoop a deal. So Warren actually took the demo tape to a birthday party that Dr. Dre was having, and he, for some way, was able to get the tape slid in and stuff. And so Dre was like, man, who is that? And stuff. And so he said, that's my homeboy I've been trying to tell you about, Snoop Dogg, man. I'm in this group 213 and stuff. And so the next night, Dre had already got the deal to do the soundtrack for Deep Cover, the movie Deep Cover. So the next night, Dre had Snoop in the studio working on the signature song that actually brought him into the game, 187. So Dre did that cut on him, and where he was featured. And when that hit the airwave, oh man, all those companies was calling me, K, Kelvin, you in Long Beach, who is this Snoop Doggy Dog guy? I said, actually A&R director and stuff. You know, don't even ask me nothing and stuff. Because really, you know, my agreement, you know, with Snoop at that time was I said, give me 6 months to get you a deal. So I really didn't have any agreement with him, unfortunately, after that. You know, I'm like, I ain't trying to hear nothing from nobody and stuff. But that's what one hit song can do for you. So that led to him being signed to the label and being featured on Dre's first album, The Chronic. And then when he got to doing his first release, which was Doggy Style, and at that time it's when he did the first music video. What's my name on the roof?
He used to give me some props in all the videos.
He used to always give me a lot of props. But I think right now, I don't know if it's The Chronic or what, but he don't remember as much as he used to. But I mean, you know, the same thing I did for him, I did for many, whether I had a relationship with them. Because my thing is that I've had a lot of people come to my store and I would listen to their music and I'm like, man, this is a very good project. I said, but unfortunately for you is that you know it and I know it. If you can't get it to the masses, it just ain't gonna never happen. I said, it's just like having the baddest car out there and it's always in the garage, or having the prettiest woman in the world and she's always in the closet. It don't mean anything. So, you know, and then the other thing too, over the years, I've had people come in my store and they fall on the counter and say, man, this is it. I done got all my life savings there, all the money I've been able to borrow and beg and steal, just right here and stuff. And, you know, I'm saying, brother, you're not even out the womb yet. I said, because regardless of how good it is, if you can't get it in the faces and in the ears of a lot of people, you just don't really have anything. So, and trust me, it's been a lot of cats, like I say, on the wrong team
that should have blew up. You've seen the scene change a lot, too. A lot of guys around Long Beach and as far as stuff happening. What do you see as the biggest change
right
in terms of people like this trying to get in the business?
Right now, everybody in here is equal. I'm telling you, it's like, you know, even though it's going to be the death of V.I.P. and stuff, unless we can really, really embrace the new technology, which is, you know, the internet, the digital thing. We, you know, because vinyl definitely physical is on its way out. And from what I'm seeing of the industry and stuff is the mindset of the industry today is more like we would rather make 10 cents a song for doing absolutely nothing than a dollar a song for manufacturing, distributing, shipping. The majors, they don't want to do that anymore. They really want you to download it because look at all these people that they can get rid of. One record company said, you know what? He said, you see this CD? He said, do you know how many people got to touch this CD before I get it? And it's still not to the consumers. That's, you know, that's the end result. That's where you want it. So we don't want to do that anymore. So the mindset of the industry today is that on release date, they want to push a button and it's released to the world and get back in the bed. What's unfortunate for the industry is that once these big contracts is up with these major artists and stuff, is that they're going to like, we can push button. You know, we don't need Warner, we don't need Interscope, we don't need Sony. And that's what's gonna happen is that artists of the future is gonna be doing their deals with iTunes, with Verizon. They need content to get to the consumer, so they don't need Warner Brothers. You know, it was just like yesterday, we was talking about doing a candlelight visual for Nate Dogg, and somebody heard that we was gonna do a candlelight visual. The next thing I know, I'm getting phone calls and stuff because it hit somebody's Facebook and Twitter. And it just like took on a life of its own because I'm like, I haven't even said okay yet, but I couldn't pull it back. And so we have to go on and do it, even though it's something that we want to do. We just weren't prepared at that time to put it all together that quickly. But we did do it. It was very successful. But, you know, that's what the internet can do for you. And it's just like right now, we got some cats in the area that have their independent projects that's out that, you know, as soon as they announce on a Facebook that it's out or put it on, you know, MySpace and also YouTube, I sell a lot of local artists, Japan, Germany, France. I mean, it's like we actually looking at, you know, and I hate that, you know, very sorry and about what's happening in Japan and stuff, because we sell a lot of music in Japan, and my heart and feeling goes out to those, you know, everybody that's over there, and everyone that's had to deal with this tragedy. But we sell a lot of music in Japan from local artists in South France, Germany, and we are actually were putting together a tour for three artists from Long Beach to go to Japan. So I don't know how long that's going to be put on hold. But today, it's like everybody got an opportunity to do great in this business, whether it's being a artist, a writer, a producer, because the internet just can allow you to do so much. Matter of fact, A&R today for a record company is online. The industry, labels pay people to set up and monitor Facebook, Twitter, and all that, because now if you were to submit a project to a record label, the first thing they're gonna ask you is, what's your fan base like? And, you know, if you ain't got nobody checking for you, they ain't trying to see it and stuff. So that's what A&R is today and stuff, is what's your audience like? So if you can blow up on YouTube like Justin Bieber, you know, you got a deal and stuff, and you got a deal you got a major deal with a lot of money. So that's all, you know, it come down to is, you know, it ain't how good your material is. They don't really care how good it is. They want to know who's checking for you. And really, even though we haven't, you know, really embraced and got into the jerk music scene, but I got a niece in Pasadena that's in a little group, and they got something on YouTube with like 5 million hits. And she called me, she's my goddaughter. She called me and said, Godfather, she said, this guy from Warner Brothers keep calling me and stuff. And it's like, so I checked it out and they like, man, we gotta have these girls and stuff. And you know, we talking to them and stuff, but you know, I'm really trying to change that culture too, because not only, you know, am I in the business of selling music and stuff, we also have like a DJ service. And like the last couple of years, parents would hire us to do, you know, play music for their kids' party. And their kids telling them that they want jerk music. And so the parents telling us that, and then I have to pull them to the side. I'm like, do you know what jerk music is? And unfortunately, it was something that was able to grow out of control without parents knowing. And it's sad that, you know, parents don't really know what their kids are listening to on the radio, because I know this minister's wife had hired us, and my guy had went out and the kids was mad at him because he wasn't playing what they wanted to hear. And so she came up and said, why are you not playing what the kids want to hear? And so he tried to explain it to him and stuff. And so he said, okay, they all got iPods, and he had an iPod connection. So he said, okay, well then I'll play it. They got it and stuff. So he just plugged the iPod in there. She almost died. But that happened and stuff, and it's like, you know, even parents coming in, you know, I want to pick up this so-and-so for, you know, for my kid and stuff. And when we explained to them, you know, what the contents of the Average Jerk song, they just, I'm saying that's what your kids listen to all day on the internet. And you know, those, you know, they think it come from, well, it hasn't yet, but it's, you know, it's only probably about so many jerk groups that actually has a major deal and stuff. But most of it is underground, and most of it is just music that you download. But again, that's what the internet can do for you. It can blow you up real big and stuff. So, you know, we definitely at that point now where we got to embrace the technology and try to get in where we fit in.
I understand. Now, if you had to pass on a piece of advice, the average person here is trying to get into business on some level, whether it was retail, whether it was as artists, producers, whatever. Mm-hmm. What would you say to an individual wanting to see a certain amount of success in the music business today?
Well, I mean, if you got the heart to do it and you know this is the line of business for you, I would say stick with it. Like I say, your opportunity today is more than it's ever been. With the new technology, with you know, the digital thing, you can do so much at home. You ain't gotta leave home to you know, promote yourself or to blow up. So, and then the other thing too is that, you know, I look back at a few artists and stuff, and I always tell this little story about Master P, Puffy, and Dr. Dre. They both kind of started out at the same time and stuff, but Dre and Puffy, they rode a supersonic jet to success. Dr. Dre had Interscope and Puffy had Arista. So those are two of the biggest giants out there. But Master P, he basically caught the bus to success, meaning that it took him about 7 years to get there, but he kept believing in that tank. And he just kept believing in it. And one day, I guess, it seemed like he was in the Bay Area or something when somebody played it. And it just blew up from that. But he never gave up. He just knew he had something, and he just kept pushing and pushing forward. And like I said, he caught the bus. Today, all you got to do is push a button, you know? And, you know, it's just all there. So, I would say that you got to embrace technology and, you know, and just stick with it because, you know, it's like the opportunities is very endless.
Hmm. All right. You mentioned, I'm going to get some questions, okay. But you also mentioned, you know, Warren. And he was a little bit different kind of guy in terms
right.
of his demeanor.
Right.
And his approach, I remember when he first came through, you know, here, he was of a little different mold. How did he fit in to what was happening?
Warren is the luckiest of the threesome. and I like Warren, and so Warren did the smartest thing. And not like Snoop, Warren ain't never told how he got a deal. But this is how Warren got a deal. John Singleton had called me one day, and he said, man, I'm working on this project. What was it? Minister Society, I think. Minister Society. And he said, I want to see if I can get Dre to produce some cuts on it. I need to see if you can put me in contact with Dre. I said, well, man, I don't have a number on Dre. I said, but it's brother Warren. I see him every day. And at that time, Warren was very upset because after Dre signed Snoop, well, Warren was more of a DJ producer type, and Dre didn't need a producer. So they had kind of shared Warren to the side, and Warren basically in the neighborhood riding a 10-speed every day. So I will never, ever forget that day. That same evening, Warren came up, and I told him, I said, Warren, I said, John Singleton called me today, and he need to get with Dre. He wanna see if Dre would produce his soundtrack he's working on. So Warren said, man, I got some stuff. He said, you think they'll listen to my stuff? I'm like, well, let's give them a call and see, Warren. So he called and he was able to get an appointment with them to present some music. And one of the songs he ended up presenting was Endo Smoke by Mr. Grimm, which was the biggest song on the project, which led to the Def Jam signing. So that's how Warren got in. And right place at the right time situation. And it's just like, to me, it's been so many other people even more deserving. But it's just, the hardest thing is the getting in, you know. And I've helped a lot of people get in it. But, you know, just like for instance, Snoop, you know, he's in because of Snoop. I mean, you got to stay in because you know all these one-hit wonders and stuff. So you gotta make it hot enough to stay in it. But the first, you know, the biggest thing is that opportunity, that shot. So you have to be ready at all times and, you know, put your best feet forward.
Well, you know, and I'm thinking like the whole thing that Nate brought to the game, they're rapping and he's got these hooks that he's singing in the content, and he ended up showing up all over the place.
Right.
At a point. Was that all part of that scene, or did people just discover him and he just started recording it?
Well, what happened with that Nate situation is that he, probably my feeling is that he started listening to people like letting them know that you got something and stuff, so you ain't got to stay within this perimeter. And then I think once, you know, the Death Row situation was over, then a lot of those guys had more freedom to do a lot of other things and stuff. So, you know, then, you know, and I'm sure good management is also important. Well, it was more important then than it is probably now. But he probably had people who helped shop a publishing company. Your publishing company would be sending stuff out to different cats and stuff. So after people saw that he was open to doing, participating in, on their project and was getting paid a lot of money to do it, you know, it was like at one point, it was like every other song that Power played, Nate was doing the hook. So he just, you know, Q had even said on one of his songs, it ain't a hit to Nate Dogg spit. So, you know, he was just hot, you know, and then when you hot like that, you just gotta embrace it and run with it. And, you know, he actually made, it was remarkable yesterday. I went on YouTube and I was just checking out. Man, this cat, he was on everybody's project at one time because I'm just looking on all of the features, you know, albums that he was featured on. It was just remarkable. And, you know, I'm sure, you know, publishing-wise that, you know, he did quite well, just those little hooks.
Yeah. Well, you know, you keep saying right place, right time. But I guess you were in the right place at the right time too, in terms of having that spot, that group of guys, and having the foresight, if you will, to provide the opportunity for them to do what they, you know, could do. Mm-hmm. Because without your support and buying that drum machine, for instance,
right,
they didn't have the resources, if you will,
right,
to make it happen. Like I said, I remember, you know, you called me to check out that studio back then, and it was, you know, it was, there were a lot of studios in Long Beach. I mean, people
right.
didn't have access to studios, so
right.
you were definitely ahead of your time.
Right.
We, Long Beach owes you a lot for the music scene, and I know a lot of the guys that came through here were all hovering around that orbit. You kept them in your orbit, and that's been a good thing. Mm-hmm. I want to open this up for some questions because it's not often that we get a chance to talk to someone who is at the heart of the business, who knows as much about the history as this gentleman. So if you would raise your hands and I'll repeat the question to make sure that we understand what the question is. You've got a question, sir.
Yes, sir. It's a two-part question. First, when V.I.P. first started, back in the days, you alluded to the fact that you were a distributorship of, you know, music.
Mm-hmm.
were you carrying your own inventory, or were you taking it on consignment?
Oh, well, at that time we had open accounts, so it was more of a, my credit was good that I didn't have to pay for anything until I sold it. So, it was, we had major accounts with all of the major labels.
Right. So the question was whether or not you carried the inventory when you had open accounts, and basically you had access back then too, right?
Yeah, we had access. Yeah. So we had a physical building in that, you know, not only, like I said, that we ship out and service our own stores, but we at one time, I would say probably a 4 or 5 year period, that we sold to basically all of the independent retail stores in Los Angeles County.
Yeah. So you had one of those games in town?
Oh yeah, we had it was like a warehouse. It was huge.
Oh, that's beautiful.
The second part to my question is, since the music industry has changed, and you are related to the fact that rather than having a dollar, you know, making a dollar and going through all the phases to make that dollar, now most of the distributors are content with just getting 10 cents in the dollar and having a download. Where would you classify VIP records in terms of their niche in the market at this point?
Okay, so just so we understand that question, because the industry has changed and the physical, as you pointed to, we're not doing a lot with physical distribution. Where is VIP now in terms of the whole food chain, if you will, and how, where do you fit in with that idea of that changing over to digital?
Okay, VIP is on life support, and we hope don't nobody kick the switch out the bar. And so, it's been like, you know, ever since 2003 is when the industry crashed. You know, that's in 2003, record companies was like, what's happening and stuff, you know? How did that happen? You know, it was like they would be in the studio for 9 months, and they project could get leaked to the internet, and it's gone. They can't get it back. You know, we was at a meeting, and the head of Universal Distribution was telling us one time in a meeting that they had, you know, all these safeguards. It was a big, I forgot what group it was, but it was a big pop act that they had spent all this money in this project. And his son came home with the project. Now, it was supposed to be on the lock and key. He almost died. You know, his son had downloaded off the internet. And it was like, you know, it was just no control. It's, the industry have a convention every year. It's called the NORM Convention, National Association of Music Retailers. And the NORM Convention is the only convention. It's gonna be in Los Angeles this year. Normally they have it in Central City. But that's the convention that I like to go to, because that's the only convention that presidents and all of the head guy owners, that's the only one that I'm aware of that they actually attend. And over the, you know, years that I've been in the business, I was always there, because not only could I find out what's going on today, I pretty much have a foresight into the future. But a few years ago I went, and they had no idea. They couldn't tell you anything. Only thing that they did to us was apologize to us, because they said that when the internet thing was rolled out, they was all asked to come in and take part in what could happen. And they all said, you know, hey, that's just like everything else that have came and gone. They said either it's gonna work for us or it's gonna fade off in the sunset. They never knew that it would jump up and bite them the way it did. They never knew that they could spend 9 months, a couple of years working on a project, and they get leaked to the internet, and now it's just out there. So that's what happened to the industry. They just, you know, no control. Today, they feel a lot better. It's unchanged a lot now. They feel a lot better. You know, you see what they've done with, what's the download site everybody's been using? LimeWire. You know, they beat that up. You know, even with my customers, I have a lot of kids. They be arguing with their mom and stuff. They'll come in and she asked for this CD, and I'm like, it's, you know, how much is it? It's $15.98. And she's like, the kid is like, Mom, I can get you three or four of them and stuff. And, but they already told them that if I catch you on line wire again, it's gonna be me and you, because, you know, everybody had problem with viruses and stuff like that, which, you know, the industry was a part of, to try to slow people down from downloading stuff on the internet. But kids now, the industry now, they know that they can, you know, their thing today is that they feel better about it and stuff, because I do feel that, you know, the industry can stop illegal download altogether. And they working their way towards it, because the more they phase out physical, they got to make sure that they get paid. And what had happened with a few months back, a customer of mine came in, and his son is real smart on the computer, and he always getting everything. And he said that his son had downloaded two brand new movies, hadn't even hit the screen yet. And right after he downloaded them, the phone rung. And the person on the other end not only told him what movie he downloaded, told him what kind of computer he downloaded it to. So the technology is there, and what they're gonna do in the future is that they're gonna make big examples out of a lot of people to kind of slow down that illegal download thing and stuff, because, you know, there's one thing about the internet, it seems like it got a fingerprint on everything that you do. And I'm just surprised of a lot of things and how a lot of people get caught up by email and sending stuff out, because once you send it out, it's going somewhere. You know, they were saying that, I saw in the news that you know, the government got on record the first tweet that was ever sent out. And the guy who did it, he said I'm on my way home. I mean, the government got access to all of that stuff. So you got people around here doing illegal things. I mean, and high profile people, politicians and all kinds of people you think are smart. Man, you ain't getting away with nothing on the internet. You might get by for a while, but you just not going to get away.
I saw your hand.
I was going to ask you, there were places where they were downloadable, or else we wouldn't have been able to know about line wire or cross whatever, cross wire, whoever was downloading. Or who put that music out there in order for them to download it?
That's a good question, but...
Well, a lot of this stuff had to do at the beginning with these peer-to-peer sites. People
exactly.
Had, I'd have a collection, you'd have a collection. The question had to do with who put the music out there so people could take it. Well, some of the first sites, like Napster and that stuff, I'd have my music collection, you'd have a music collection, and that would be a server. And I would give you access to my collection, and we would just swap music. Right. But everybody in the middle who should get paid, the producers, the artists, the retailers, nobody right. got their money, so that meant the industry started to crumble because the music was being literally stolen.
But it's being put out there. Okay, my point is, if you put your collection out there, both of you out where everybody can see it, it's not a private place where you could have.
What you got to understand, though, that was an internet setup. Companies set themselves up so that they could host. There were people who were at the forefront of this, mm-hmm. and they set up servers that allowed them to host these communities. They were social communities, right. just like other social communities. But at that stage of the game, the laws weren't in place to handle it. And when the laws got in place, and that's what, you know, Kelvin is saying, when the laws are now coming in place, that's what a stop is being put to.
Right. And, you know, just like he was saying, you know, I could record something and put it online. It's just like now, you'll go online to download somebody's music from the internet, and you'll see that it's a good copy, it's a bad copy. It's because, you know, you got individuals downloading it to these sites that...
But they can't, nobody else can download.
Well, yeah, I mean, one, none of that done legally. I mean, unless the label downloaded it, but most of it is illegal.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
Yeah, I have two questions if it's time for it. I wanted to ask, like, do you think there's a way to preserve, you know, tangible forms of music by, you know, maybe through, like, packaging or adding, like, multimedia to, you know, the content as far as, because, like, I had an idea with my music, like, a couple years ago. Like, when people, so I'm from Atlanta, people was heavy in the bootleg, you know, everybody. Mm-hmm. I was like, if I saw my music with video content on it, you know what I'm saying? Because they had, you know, the black music, all the music and video. Mm-hmm. If I did that, that would kind of deter a lot of bootlegging and also make people want to buy it, because not only do I have the music, but I also have the video or whatever multimedia content is on that disc. Mm-hmm. I know that's not a new idea.
Right.
Companies probably been thinking about that, but do you mm-hmm. think that can preserve, you know, tangible forms of music?
Yeah, that's a value added situation, whereas and a few of the labels did kind of get involved with that because, you know, they found out that, you know, the packaging wasn't helping them any, and, you know, it didn't kind of increase the value. So we'll do a value added, and a lot of times they would, you know, do a bonus track, video or documentary type footage also on it. So yeah, that helped us a lot with, you know, for a while. And then I don't too much know why they don't do it as much, but they have started off really getting involved with that. But it's something.
Probably too expensive or something, you think, maybe?
You know what, it's probably a contractual situation and stuff, because it's just like, we've always told record companies that, like, the customers want more music videos and stuff. First, when, you know, everybody started buying these automobiles with the screens in it, the DVDs and all that, we like telling record companies, well, they were like, well, we can't clear it through management and stuff. It's like a trip, man. It's like, didn't y'all pay to get the video done? It's like, yeah, but, you know, contractually, we can't make it available for sale. I'm like, man, that's what, you guys can make a lot of money, man. It's so much stuff that the industry, you know, done over the years that just did not make sense. And it's funny that labels used to go to New York a lot, you know, the labels like Def Jam and Bad Boy, and they were like, Def Jam, it's like they would call me, Lior's secretary would call me and like, Lior want to know if you busy this weekend. I'm like, well, no. So he wants you to come to New York, and he got some stuff he want to run by you. So I would go and listen to their whole presentation on what they're getting ready to put out, listen to their marketing ideas and stuff, and then I would tell them not, you know, I'm like, this not gonna work and stuff. They always value my opinion, but they never did nothing I said. But they wanted to know, because they know that I was the type of person was gonna give them an honest opinion. I wasn't just trying to get in and say, yeah, man, that's good and stuff. But, you know, and 9 times out of 10, it would go just the way I said it would go. And then they like, oh man, you know, I should have listened to you or something. But yeah, that was one of the things that, you know, evidently the record company wasn't getting enough. They didn't figure that it enhanced the sale as much as they thought, because they had started off doing that, but then it's for some reason, well, it's fading away, because this is the part of their commitment to get out of the physical. They don't want to do it. They don't want to manufacture. They don't want to ship. So, and then I'm still hearing that, you know, more than 75% of the money that's made is still in physical. I can't understand why they trying to get out of it. And then it's just like, you know, my argument when I sit down in meetings and stuff, I don't go to meeting like I used to, but when things were falling apart, you know, I would, because, you know, the industry said the consumer drive the industry. But I'm like, no, the industry drive the consumer. I said, because I know for a fact that people didn't stop buying 8-tracks. You stopped making them. So they had to buy the cassette. You know, they didn't stop buying cassette. You stopped making them. So they had to buy the CD. I said, so you drive the industry. The industry, you know, don't drive you and stuff. So, and that's, you know, basically what's happening now is that, you know, they got releases coming out this year that's not going to be a physical CD. It's only going to be a digital release and stuff. So, you know, that's going to be, you know, I would say in the next 3 years, the only music stores, physical music stores that'll be around is the stores that's into buy, sell, and trade and stuff, because those stores are still doing good. I talked to Bagatelle's over here on 3rd and Atlantic, and their business really hadn't changed that much, because he said he sell the same CD on the average around 7 times. You know, somebody will buy it and take it home and bring it back, and they'll clean it up and they'll sell it again. So his inventory comes from his customers, you know, where I buy from companies and stuff. Yeah. So those kind of stores, you know, Amoeba in Hollywood, it just blew me away the first time. And Amoeba had been open a long time before I ever visited. And I went in there at 10 o'clock at night, and it was a line at the checkout. And I'm like, what the heck? So, you know, and you know, they into, you know, and I mean, the line of people selling music to them was as long as the line of people checking out and stuff. So they got that circle of inventory where, you know, they buy deals, they buy cutouts, which is when the record companies close out something, they'll bring it back in, punch a hole in it, and sell it to somebody like Amoeba for, you know, pennies. And then they'll put it on their shelf. So stores like that is the stores of the future, because in the future, the only physical music that the majors are going to make is for marketing promotion purposes only.
So we've got to be thinking something other than physical releases.
Oh, yeah. I mean, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, as much as I hate to say it, that's real.
Yeah.
And the second part of my question? The second part of my question was, you know, as a solo artist, you know what I'm saying, an artist who does everything yourself, you know what I'm saying, I know what you were saying, like, with the new era of future, you can do everything yourself, push a button. My biggest problem, I'm sure, for a lot of other artists, is allotment of time. You know what I'm saying? So, besides the music-making process, what is the second most important place to, you know, allot your time towards, or put your time towards?
That's a good question.
Okay, as far as now, let me understand that question again.
What his question had to do with the use of his time as an artist. He spends so much time producing, but he only has so much time.
Mm-hmm.
Where should he devote his time? What would be the best return for investment of time other than just producing?
Oh, okay. Well, yeah, you, outside of, you know, creating something and stuff, you got to start, you know, really marketing it and promoting it. I got a couple of guys that I work with that's writers, producers. And, you know, it's like right now they're shopping their music to, like, companies that's into computer games, movies, commercials. It's like a lot of money to be made in those fields and stuff, video games. It's just, you know, it's endless. But, you know, the thing is that, you know, you just got to, you got to be able to, you know, package yourself, you know, and present yourself, whether it's through, you know, your Facebook or YouTube or whatever and stuff. And the other thing too, you gotta learn to enjoy life too, because we get caught up, you know, in the business so much until, you know, you just, you know, sometimes you have to just take a break from it and kind of think.
Do you still see the record stores a place like, does the record store still have responsibility to be cultural curators as far as, like, you know, as a storefront?
It's still important to us, you know, according to the industry now, The industry don't feel that way. The powers to be, they don't feel that way. And the worst thing that ever happened to the music companies, the record business, is that it started being ran by non-music people. You know, it started being ran by guys that's big on Wall Street and stuff like that. They don't have an idea and stuff. So that's the worst. That's the worst thing that ever happened to the music business. And then the other thing too, how the industry look at that. You know, if the industry didn't feel so good about the online situation, Warehouse would still be here. Musicland would still be here. Circuit City would have did a lot better and stuff like that. So now the industry is just looking at, it's just like, for instance, you know, Warner Brothers. It used to be, I used to have like around 13 reps that I could call in the LA area from Warner Brothers for whether it was marketing, promotion, and whatever. Now they have one person that works from here to Texas and somebody else works from Texas. It's only two people doing the job of hundreds of people. I mean, it's just empty. I mean, it's like where I had all these relationships and knew all these people. I barely know anybody at any of these companies now because the old cast have been pushed out. And they brought in, you know, new, younger people that's more computer, you know, literate, that can make their things happen. Because not only, you know, they look at the online for marketing promotion, they look on it also to get new acts and stuff. So that's what I'm saying. They got, you know, they A&R department is sitting there watching Twitter and Facebook and all that kind of stuff. So, you know, it's just all new today. But, you know, you retail stores does a lot, and what we're doing a lot now with, like I said, local independent cast that's, you know, trying to get out there and get things going. You know, we're about to start doing more in stores now where, you know, they can send a blast out to all the fans and stuff that, you know, come down to a CD signing or performance at the store, something like that. So it's still, I'm sure for the future, what will keep independent stores around is the local independent acts and stuff, because I still feel that it's a physical avenue for local cats. I just know that the industry is not, the majors are not going to invest the dollars to make that happen. Mm-hmm.
So that whole point of the role of the store has changed.
Right.
Basically, in answer to his question about your right. role to promote, like back in the day, you could have a studio, you could have the local high school kids come in
right.
and do music and promote that music and then help them shop a deal. That's yeah. going by the wayside, you say?
Yeah, that's totally out the door and stuff. Yeah, they don't. That ain't the way it's done anymore because the industry is just not interested in making an investment. It's just like when we did great, you know, we would call a record company and say, hey, you know, we think this project will do well and stuff. Let me send you a marketing proposal on what we can do here at VIP. And then they'll take a look at it, and a lot of time they will buy into it and stuff, where we do radio, you know, we decorate the store, we do all of that. And one thing that I had to, you know, I had to rechange the thinking of record companies, the record labels, a long time ago, is that they always felt like that, you know, when we, for us to get mileage out of our advertising money, is that we got to advertise somebody like Warehouse or somebody who got like hundreds of stores. But I had to tell them that no, advertising is advertising. I said, because every time you do a big promotion on Ice Cube at Warehouse, I said, well, my customers are going to feel like if Warehouse got it, I should have it. So they're going to come to me anyway. So I had to let them know that marketing works. I don't care whose name you put in the front of it. Most people are going to go to, you know, if it's music, a VIP customer are going to pretty much come to VIP anyway. So what that, you know, did for us was it allow us to, you know, be more a part of the marketing scheme. But like the reason why it ain't no warehouse, the record company, warehouse, music land, music plus stores like that used to get financially in trouble. And the record company said, man, we got to rescue them. And they did, time after time. You know, they would come in and rescue them, but now they're saying, we don't need them. And so that's the reason why those chain stores are no longer there and stuff. The reason why Best Buy's finna get out of the music business and, you know, the Walmart section have shrunk so much, and same thing at Target, is that the industry have always paid them to bring their music in. When you see it on the end cap or something like that, they got paid a lot of money for that. The industry said, we ain't doing that no more. So Best Buy said, well, I can use that space for more electronics or something. So it used to, for a chain store or a big box store to carry product, they carried it because they were paid to carry it. And the fact that they were paid to carry it, then they could sell it for a lot more, because in actuality, they paid a lot less for it. And being, you know, in distribution, you know, a part of my history being in distribution, I know. I used to buy 10,000 pieces and get 1,000 free. And all of the advertising, you know, enough advertisement to be on 3 or 4 stations. So that's the reason why, you know, Walmart could sell stuff so cheap, they really didn't pay that much for it when you look at how they was compensated.
You got another question?
Yeah, there's basically, you were saying it, but why are you saying that these people can get major deals now? Why would a record company do major deals when people are going independent?
Well, they're not going to want them to go independent. It's just that people are just going to wise up and see that, you know, I can do for myself what you're saying you can do for me. Now, they will still look at somebody like a Justin Bieber and stuff. And it's just like now when somebody get a deal now, they own way more of you than they used to. You know, they want part of your... You know, everything that you involved with, they want to get paid for.
But if they were taught like by Mr. Shaw here, you know, they would know that they don't have to go there. Unfortunately, times change. We know we can do everything ourselves.
Right.
And everything I make is mine.
Exactly.
But at the same time, think back to what Kelvin said a minute ago. Unless you can get it in front of a lot of people,
right,
everything you can make is yours, but it's going to be this much as opposed to this much. A little piece of a Justin Bieber deal is probably a lot, mm-hmm, because that's a lot of people that it's in front of. Whereas, you know, we're still doing the same math, and you get to keep more, and you might not need as many fans,
right,
but it's still back to a numbers game at some point. We got time for a few more questions. We're getting ready to wind down a little bit because we're getting about that time. Now, we don't want to wear out your welcome here, but let's take another one.
With that in mind and the advancement of technologies, what do you think the role of record labels will be in the future?
The role of the record label in the future, okay.
Well, I think they're going to have to get back into finding people that, you know, really need help. In order to, and I think that they're not going to be able to keep an artist as long as they would like, more than likely and stuff, because, you know, it's just going to be like an athlete once he's a free agent and stuff, you know, his price is going to go up, and, you know, they're pretty much going to probably have to just let him go, because like I said, that, you know, artists are just going to be smart enough to know that they don't need a label. Now, a lot of them will, you know, just break the bank and pay some of these guys to stay there. But, you know, they just figure that, you know, that it's just probably worth it to, you know, for their image of having this particular artist, you know, on the label. But I just know for a fact that you know, the future of these companies, you know, is just right around the corner. That they just
be the giants that they used to be.
Exactly. And what they're gonna get off into, it's just like I just heard recently that Jimmy Iovine over at Interscope, I think he's already doing like an energy drink. And also he's doing some kind of glasses, some kind of shades and stuff that he's really getting. So they gonna diversify and get off into a lot of the other
merchandising.
Yeah.
A lot of merchandise.
And they seeing, they learning from the artists. We gotta touch some other areas and stuff. So
revenue stream.
Exactly.
Other revenue stream.
Yeah.
Couple more questions before we have Mr. Anderson exit today. We got an opportunity. Couple more questions before we close it down. Anybody else got another one? Nah. Go ahead.
Yeah, I was gonna say, it's kind of lightweight answering my question a little bit. I was gonna say, I think where the record labels, the outsiders gonna have to come in is where, like what I was trying to say, the question I was trying to answer earlier, was like allotment of time. Like no one person, I'm finding a struggle myself, like no one person is gonna be able to do everything yourself and then be able to make money out of it on top of that.
Oh, okay.
You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, you might be able to do it all, but
right.
Then to get to that avenue of making money off of it.
Right. Well, no, you do need a team and stuff because, I've had cats like that, you know, where I just said, man, just stick to producing, stick to your writing or whatever.
Or even people like you who say, like, you know what I'm saying, like, okay, this music is good. You know what I'm saying? People still going to need
right.
a person to tell them, like, oh, this is a hit.
Right.
This is a good song. Oh, no, this is trash. Why are you putting it out?
Right, and I don't know how some people get on American Idol, but it's always good to have a team. Yeah, it's always good to have a team because you got that other thought process there, and definitely, the fact that, you know, it would just, for somebody that's being creative, you know, like most artists are and stuff like that, they don't need to worry about, you know, who's gonna do, you know, this, that, or the other. So no, the team aspect is still good. My point more so in that statement was that you don't need a deal.
Yes.
So no, you do not. You don't need a deal to be successful in this business and stuff. You don't need somebody else doing something that you can basically do yourself.
And it comes back to the product. You do at some point have to have a product.
Right.
That you can take to the market
right.
and get it in front of somebody's face.
Right.
Whether and you have a deal or not, you gotta have that.
What I've always told people is that I'd rather have a mediocre project and great marketing promotion than great marketing than the other way around. Because like I say, you know, and it goes back to, you know, the times where we try to sell somebody something and they say but once they hear it 50 times and see the video 20 times, then they come back and say, oh man, I'm feeling that now. So it's all gonna come down to marketing promotion and the way social media is today, you know, you can be out there, you know, like huge, right? You know, I mean, you can post it tonight and get sales tomorrow.
That's right. That's all you mean.
Getting back to the Warren G era, that he brought forward a group called Dove Check.
Yeah, because of that relationship that they had with Warren, Warren was able to get them, you know, a deal also. And one thing about Def Jam is that Def Jam was never really a West Coast type of label. And they just really, you know, didn't really embrace it. You know, they didn't even do what they could have done, you know, for like Domino, which its project went through there. And even Jail Felony. I mean, one of my trips to New York, I like really pushed the button on Jail Felony and stuff and told them how good an act this was. And, you know, they did get behind that particular project. And then it actually did real good. It actually started moving across the country. But, you know, Def Jam, like I said, they was like, they made a lot of money and was very arrogant. And it's like, you know, they just never really, really felt the West Coast. I mean, when they did that little deal with Dub C and stuff, they just dropped the ball on it because, you know, they just did it. But, you know, they really weren't feeling West Coast artists.
Okay. All right. If we don't have any more questions, we really, 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 really appreciate you taking the time to check
out. I appreciate being here.
And again, you know, I just want to say that when you look at the history of the music, whatever area you're in, there are always going to be people kind of behind the scenes that just make stuff happen, and stuff just kind of happens, and it happens in their orbit. And these are the people that are responsible for a lot of the careers that we see. And you kind of go, well, where did this guy come from? Where did this guy? Well, how did that happen? Well, there has to be somebody back there supporting that whole thing. Resources count for a lot of our ability to do what we do. If you don't have resources, it's hard to continue, you know, on your path, whatever that path is. Mm-hmm. And Mr. Anderson has been at the heart of supporting a lot of the guys who are now big stuff, as right. you call it. Right. So, again, thank you so much.
Thank you. All right. All right. No problem.
All right, everybody, you know how to get on the internet, sign in this week. This is a sign-in week, and we do. And go down to V.I.P., by the way.
That's right.
Go down to V.I.P. and support the local music stuff. You know, and quit stealing all that music up there.
Yeah, we don't charge you anything to come in.
Yes.
All right, good to see you.